سبحان الله سبحان والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. And welcome to a new episode of Islam Unveiled. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Most Merciful, praise be to Allah alone, and may the best peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and all the prophets and messengers of God. Brothers and sisters everywhere, and my beloved brothers here in the studio, I greet you with the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. In the previous episode, one of our beloved brothers asked a question about how should be the nature of the relationship between Muslims and non-Muslims? How should Muslims treat non-Muslims, whether they are fellow citizens, neighbors, or living abroad? We did answer in a little bit, and we promised to broaden the answer in the following episode. And we're here to fulfill this promise from it right now. Where we dedicated this episode to speak about tolerance in Islam, religious tolerance in Islam. Since the very beginning of Islam, Islam taught its followers to respect the beliefs of others. And that's stemming from the very fact that Allah created every human being with the free will to choose. That's why you might find within the same household some people who may accept faith and some people who may reject it. And Muslims would not force their relatives or those who are under their guardianship or their fellow citizens, or their neighbors, to adopt their faith. Because Allah the Almighty stated in the Quran in several positions. For instance, in one place, Allah the Almighty told His Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتْ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. You guide not those whom you love. It is only Allah who guides whomever He wills. So guidance and accepting the truth and believing in the oneness of God is a gift from God. If the person shows willingness, then Allah the Almighty would facilitate accepting guidance for him. But if somebody does not believe, he does not want to accept the fact that God is one. He doesn't want to comply with His command. Belief, as we stated since the very first episode, is a submission. That when you say, I am a Muslim, that declares that you're willing to comply and implement the commands of God on earth. So it is not just a word to be said by the mouth or to be uttered by the tongue. It has requirements and responsibilities to be fulfilled. That's why Allah made it very clear. In the second chapter of the Quran, and by now everybody knows the second chapter of the Quran is called Al-Baqarah. In a beautiful verse, He said, لا إكراه في الدين. There should not be any compulsion in religion. Why? قَدْ تَبَيَّنَ الرُّشْدُ مِنَ الْغَيْهِ. Righteousness has become very clear and obvious and distinct from wickedness, from disbelief. Whomsoever it chooses to be rightly guided, he is holding and grasping on a trustworthy handle. And this matter is a matter of choice. So Allah teaches us in the Quran that you cannot force anyone to accept faith or belief. As a matter of fact, in Surah Yunus, Yunus is one of the names of the prophets who's mentioned in the Quran in verse number 99. Allah the Almighty says, وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَآمَنَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كُلُّهُمْ جَمِيعًا. If your Lord willed, all of those who are on earth, all mankind would have accepted faith and became Muslims. But this is the quality of giving human beings the free will, the choice. He gave them the flashlight. He gave them the guidance. He said, وَهَدَيْنَاهُ النَّجْدَيْنِ. We showed mankind the two ways, the good and the bad. Then it is your call. But based on your call, you bear the consequences. You're responsible for your choice. Then he addressed Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, by saying, أَفَأَنْتَ تُكْرِهُ النَّاسَ حَتَّى يَكُونُوا مُؤْمِنِينَ. Will you then, O Muhammad, peace be upon him, compel mankind in order to accept faith? You're not required to do that. It is very interesting to know that from among the family of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, some of those who did not accept Islam, his own uncle. Some who were neutral, he neither accepted Islam nor did he oppose Prophet Muhammad or deny his message, such as Abu Talib. As a matter of fact, he was supporting him, but he died without accepting faith. On the other hand, there was another uncle who opposed him from day one. He rather believed in idols and he worshipped idols. So, we are commanded to deliver the message of God in a peaceful way, and we're not responsible for people's choice. We cannot force anyone to accept faith. It is a matter of belief. And belief is only concerned with the heart. And you cannot control people's hearts. It is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who does so. Accordingly, it is very important to remember altogether some of the events from the very beginning of the Muslim Ummah, indicating and showing and proving how Islam taught tolerance and respect to others' beliefs. For instance, when Prophet Muhammad, peace upon him, migrated to Al-Madinah, and now there is a Muslim state, and he had powerful followers who were all soldiers carrying swords and willing to fight. He defeated the enemies who came all the way from Mecca to attack them in Medina. They were all utterly defeated. He arrested and imprisoned 70 of them. So that means now they had some sort of power and strength. He could have expelled the Jews from day one from Al-Madinah, whom we stated that they happened to be living in Al-Madinah at the same time. Yet Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, did not do that. Instead, he welcomed them. And he established treaties with them, treaties of respect, of respecting each other's faith, not forcing any of them to accept Islam or to enter Islam. They work freely, they worship freely, they maintain their synagogues and everything. Until they violated the treaties. One of the articles of the treaties was to defend Al-Madina, the city in which Muslims and Jews were all living together in, against his enemies. So they did not only violate the treaty by not supporting Muslims against their enemies, rather, they paid the enemies in order to attack Al-Madina. And while Muslims were on the front yard fighting the enemies, they happened to attack Muslims, the weak and women, inside in Al-Madina. Not only that, once again, they made several attempts to assassinate Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. As a result of that, they have been forced to leave Al-Madina. They did not leave Al-Madina, or they were not asked to depart Al-Madina on account of disbelief or polytheism or because of being Jews. No, not at all. As a matter of fact, we need to remember the statement of a Jewish rabbi, a former Jewish rabbi, who accepted Islam later on, whose name is Abdullah ibn Salam. He said, when Muhammad, peace be upon him, came to Al-Madinah, I was amongst the first to rush to see him, because they have read in their books, in the Old Testament, the prophecies of the appearance of the last prophet in the city of the dead palm trees. And that's why they migrated to Al-Madinah initially. So when he had seen him, he said, once I laid my eyes on his face, I recognized that he is a man of the truth. And he's not a liar. He's got to be the prophet. And among the very first words that I heard from him was, أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ أَفْشُوا السَّلَامِ وَأَطْعِمُوا الطَّعَامِ وَصَلُّوا بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّاسُ نِيَامِ تَدْخُلُوا جَنَّةَ رَبِّكُمْ بِسَلَامِ. He said, among what I heard first from this man, from Muhammad, peace be upon him, was, he said, O people, spread peace. Spread the message of peace, the greeting of peace. The greeting of Islam is, peace be with you. Spread the greeting of peace. Feed the poor. And pray at night while people are asleep. If you do that, you shall enter the heaven of your Lord, paradise, safely. تَدْخُلُوا جَنَّةَ رَبِّكُمْ بِسَلَامِ. So that was the message of Prophet Muhammad from the beginning. A delegation of the Christians from Najran, a neighborhood, they came, they visited with the Prophet ﷺ in Medina. He hosted them in his own mosque. For a few days, he fed them, he honored them, and he offered them his message. And he showed them the revelation from God. By the end of the story, they did not accept Islam. And nobody was hurt. They left peacefully, safely, and nobody was forced to accept Islam. So this is very important to understand. Many people like to propagate the idea of a holy war and that Muslims are commanded to spread Islam by the sword or Islam was spread by the sword. But history proves otherwise. History proves that Islam entered most of the countries, most of the world, without fight. Islam in Malaysia, Indonesia, and Pakistan, and India, and those countries entered via the way that Muslims dealt as merchants with non-Muslims, who happened to be following various types of religions and faith and belief. They dealt with Muslims. They liked the idea of monotheism. Muslims were true representatives of Islam, so accordingly they were inclined into accepting Islam. And now, while Muslims are weak with regards to military forces and armed forces, yet Islam is still widespread to the point that Islam is the fastest growing religion on earth. So if the theory that Islam was spread by the sword was true, then it was supposed to be the opposite. Since Muslims are very weak in power, don't have the military which is capable to attack and invade other countries, or even defend themselves, that supposedly that we should see more Muslims departing Islam into other religions. But the fact proves that more and more and more people coming from every other religion and entering Islam, singles and in groups. In the United States of America, in the most advanced country, where I wouldn't say that we're paying any person money or giving him food or assistance or tempting them with any worldly gain in order to accept Islam, Muslims are entering Islam on a daily basis more than anywhere else, more than in Africa itself. There is more to talk about tolerance in Islam after the short break, so please stay tuned.
If you're 18 or if you're 80, if you've been Muslim for 50 years or 5 minutes, this is a show for you. You know, when five times a day our foreheads touch the ground in prayer, we beg for what's most important in our lives. We want to be good people, better Muslims. We want to serve Allah Almighty with all our hearts. In the show Let's Talk, every week we're going to talk about Islam and life, how to relate with other people and how to serve Allah. We'll have studio guests, we'll have a live studio audience. There'll be an email for you to write to, talk@huda.tv. So if you're looking for something different, looking for something that will make you think, maybe even touch your heart, this is the show for you.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. Welcome back, speaking about tolerance in Islam. The religious tolerance in Islam was taught from the very beginning of the Muslim state with the revelation of the Quran and the teachings of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and inherited by his successors. The second caliph of the four rightly guided caliphs, his name was Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him. Upon taking over Palestine, brothers and sisters, is the third most sacred place on earth for Muslims. The first is Mecca, second is Medina, and third is Jerusalem. So it is the land of the messages of prophets. There, when Muslims took over, and Umar ibn Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, came all the way from Medina, he walked on foot prior to entering Jerusalem. Out of humility, he was lowering his head, out of humility, not showing pride and arrogance because he defeated the people of the scriptures using Christians. No. As a matter of fact, the patriarch of Jerusalem handed over the key to Umar ibn Khattab and they signed the treaty altogether. All the synagogues and all the churches have been preserved and maintained 1400 years ago. Compare the Muslim rule over Palestine to what's happening today. The destruction of the mosques, banning Muslims from entering the farthest mosque in order to pray, putting blocks everywhere, making people's lives miserable. But when they were living under the Muslims' rule, everybody was able to practice freely their religion. Unlike also what happened on the year 1099, where 70,000 men, women, and children were slaughtered, accompanying the arrival of the Crusaders. While Umar ibn Khattab entered Jerusalem and took over the key peacefully without bloodshed of a single person. This is Islam, and these are the teachings of Islam. We see that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, upon sending an army to a battlefield, will stop its leader and teach him a lesson and say, make sure you don't target civilians. You don't burn homes, nor harvest, nor plants. You do not uproot trees. You do not destroy the civil life of people. And if you find worshippers in places of worship, do not target them. The places of worship have been preserved and maintained all over the Muslim countries after Islam have been taken over until today, which is erected as the best indication that Islam is a tolerant religion. It does not force anybody to change their faith. In Egypt, for instance, till today, there are places of worship which have been there even before Islam have entered by Amr ibn al-As to Egypt, which indicates that Muslims did not force the Copt nor the Christians to change their faith, their religion, which is a great indication that tolerance is a basic foundation in Islam. I think somebody has a question.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
My name is Khalid. I am from Bosnia. I have a question. What do you think of banning minarets in Switzerland? Should Muslims not react the same?
I think and I believe, really, this is a very valid and important question. And since your name is Khalid, right? You said you're from Bosnia. So you have lived the horror of the genocide which had been taking place by the Crusaders, as I would call it, the Crusaders in Bosnia. In the modern age, we have seen hundreds of thousands of Muslims who have been massacred, women who have been raped by the Crusaders in the modern age. And the media was watching and covering all of that as the best indication that this is the practice of other religions, not Islam. One thing I wanted to refer to before answering the question, which is the phrase, the holy war, which the media, the Western media in particular, like to label Islamists with. They say that they call for a holy war. The Quran calls its followers for a holy war to fight non-Muslims to make them accept Islam. And it is very amazing. It is nowhere in the entire Quran where it says a holy war. Then when we searched in history and you go back to references and dictionaries, we found out that the phrase and the term holy war was coined first by the Crusaders themselves. When they encouraged the soldiers to fight against Muslims in Palestine and kill them in order to enter paradise. So the price for entering paradise was to kill a Muslim or to kill as many Muslims as possible. Now, with banning the minarets in Switzerland, I find it very strange, and it really shows that how intolerant those people are towards others, especially when you know that when we hear minarets, 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 we think that there are hundreds of thousands of minarets. But in fact, there are only 4 minarets all over the country. And those 4 minarets seem to be annoying the right wing big time. They cannot sleep because of those symbols of Islam, just 4 minarets. Imagine if Muslims, for instance, in a country like Egypt, where there are thousands of minarets for churches, have decided to react with the same. The Christian population in Egypt is less than 5%, according to the latest survey. So if we make a survey amongst Muslims, would you like to leave the churches or demolish them? What will happen? So if we have people who would deal with the situation emotionally and get carried away, that you would have the vast majority vote for demolishing not just the minarets and the crosses, but wiping out the churches. But Muslims do not react based on emotions. Rather, we react based on justice. What does the Quran teach? What does Allah the Almighty tell us? And how should we deal with non-Muslims? I found a very interesting hadith That's collected by Abu Dawood in it. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, says, he who unfairly treats a non-Muslim who keeps a peace treaty with a Muslim or with Muslims, or undermines his rights or burdens him beyond his capacity or takes something from him without his consent, then I am his opponent on the Day of Judgment. Here is Prophet Muhammad himself is saying that I will be his opponent on the Day of Judgment, one who will undermine the rights or confiscate the properties or oppress or hurt or persecute a non-Muslim who's living in a Muslim country or is having a treaty with any Muslim. This is our way of life. This is how we should deal with non-Muslims. So we're not going to react the same. Otherwise, it will be a chaos. But the media should present what's happening in some of the most free countries and shed some light on the not completely unbiased democracy and freedom. Rather, I would call it hypocrisy, because it would only be free for people to disbelieve, free for people to choose whatever. But when it comes to Muslims practicing their faith, especially when you know that the minarets do not have loudspeakers, do not produce any noise. For instance, brothers and sisters, in the United States, it's been now almost 9 years, we've been trying to get a permit to build an Islamic center. We bought a property somewhere, but we have to get, in addition to a list of permits from others, we have to get also the consent of the neighbors. So if some of the neighbors object, they say, we don't like the way that the mosque would look like, or the minaret, or the dome, or whatever, it would annoy us. They have the right to object. The case has been in a court for more than 9 years. We're waiting, waiting, waiting. That's not the case in any of the Muslim countries. If we react the same, it will be a chaos. Nabil, you have a question?
Yes, sir. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. My name is Nabil Ahmed from Pakistan. My question is, how can a person maintain good relation with his neighbor and he is non-Muslim?
Well, Allah the Almighty teaches it in the Quran. He says, وَالْجَارِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْجَارِ الْجُنُوبِ وَالصَّاحِبِ بِالْجَنْبِ ذِنْ وَبِنِ السَّبِيلِ وَمَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ etc. In this verse, in the beginning, it is in chapter An-Nisa, or the women. And Allah the Almighty commanded to worship Him alone, etc. And one of the commands is to be good to the neighbors. Any kind of neighbor, whether he is a Muslim and relative, a Muslim and not related to you, or not even a Muslim, he still have rights upon you. And the rights of the neighbors are plenty, whether a Muslim or a non-Muslim. To the extent that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, Jibreel, Angel Gabriel, continue to enjoin upon me the rights of the neighbors and to be kind and nice and good to the neighbors, to the point that I thought that the neighbor is going to inherit me. The neighbor is going to be considered one of my family members. As a matter of fact, those teachings and this etiquette in Islam towards neighbors made many non-Muslims enter Islam. For instance, there was one person who happened to be a neighbor to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Meanwhile, he was not a Muslim. And he was a great opponent to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. He monitored whenever Prophet Muhammad leaves his house to the prayer. So he would dump the trash and harmful things on his way. And on a constant basis, he used to do that. So one day, Prophet Muhammad left his house and he missed the trash. The road was clean. So he inquired about the man who dumps the trash every morning. They said that he is sick. So he went to visit him. This is our Prophet, who is our role model, whom we were commanded in the Quran. In the verse 21st of Surah Al-Ahzab, chapter Al-Ahzab, where Allah the Almighty says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرَةِ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. And that verse means, indeed, in the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad, peace be upon him, for you, for the believers, is the best example and the role model to be followed for those who believe in Allah and the last day and remember Allah much. So, the true Muslims are good to their neighbors, whether they're Muslims or non-Muslims. As a matter of fact, Prophet Muhammad once, in one hadith, released a very serious threat. And he said, by Allah, he does not believe. They said, who does not believe? He said, one whom his neighbor does not feel safe from his harm. Whether this neighbor is a Muslim or a non-Muslim. There is abundant information about the beautiful teachings of Islam. But unfortunately, we cannot encompass everything in one episode. And that's why, once again, we ran out of time. And until next episode, I leave you in peace. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. Glory be to Allah, all praise to Allah. There is no God but Allah, Allah is great. All power and might belong to Allah, the Most High, the Great.